Pennsylvania German Hour is underwritten by the Pennsylvanische Deutsche Versammlung von Baddox County, the state's largest annual Pennsylvania Dutch language gathering, held the first Monday after Easter in the Leesport Auction Hall. For more information, please call Joyce Hassler at 717-866-3431. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the West Berks Versammlung, held annually on the first Saturday in October in Robezonia. For more information, please call Kathy Shellhammer at 610-390-1088. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the Rentschler-Leib family and Reverend Richard Miller and family. The Pennsylvania German Hour is produced in cooperation with the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center at Kutztown University, the hub of Pennsylvania Dutch culture and language. Contact us at 610-683-1589. Or at www.kutztown.edu/pgchc. Mir sala gross dank zu alle unser Unterstützer.
Gute Maria, liebe Gucke, und willkommen zum Pennsylvanisch Deutschstund, the best blots for Deutsch zu hören auf BCTV. Heute ist der 5. Juni 2020. Und es ist ein unerschädlicher Frühjahr als wie andere Jahre. Die Frühjahr kommt langsam, es ist kiel und schee draus und Sommer ist schier gordo. Es ist für sure ein schwer und harte Zeit für unsere Familie und liebe Freunde nicht zu zähne kennen und alle unsere jährlichen Feste nicht zu halten. Aber zwei Dinge sind wahr. Mir deutsche Leute sind hartnäckig und geduldig. Und wenn wir dadurch die Gefahrlichkeit kommen sind, waren wir all ready zu feiern, wenn es sicher für das zu tun ist. Today we'd also like to honor someone very important to us here at the Pennsylvania German Hour on BCTV, Rachel M. Stump, who passed away just shortly after our last episode at the age of 102. Rachel passed away of natural causes on May 4th, 2020 in her residence in Wernersville, PA. She was predeceased by her husband, Herbert J. Stump, who died on July 4th in the year 2000. Born in South Heidelberg Township, she was a daughter of the late Levi H. Koch and A. Rachel Zeller Koch. She was a retired cafeteria worker at Lower Heidelberg Elementary School in the Wilson Schools and a full-time homemaker. She was the oldest member of the Pennsylvania German singing group, the Doppelhock Sanger Corps, that is featured every month here on BCTV, and she served as its president for more than 10 years, performing at various Pennsylvania German festivals and monthly on BCTV. She was a lifelong member of St. Daniel's Lutheran Church in Robezonia, PA, and her church work and her family were her greatest joys. She also loved flowers and gardening and was a quilter for more than 20 years at her church. She is survived by three sons, H. Theodore and his wife Diane of Aurora, Colorado, Byron K. and his wife Mary of West Friendship, Maryland, and Gregory J. and his wife Deborah of South Windsor, Connecticut. Other survivors include her brother, Donald L. Koch of Wernersville, PA, as well as four grandchildren, Benjamin, Jonathan, Christopher, and Sarah, and six great-grandchildren, Jordan, Jake, Hannah, Haley, Owen, and Adeline. She was predeceased by sister Maisie Oxenrider, her brother Leroy A. Koch, and her brother Robert F. Koch, and sister Helene Lutz. Many of these siblings of hers were deeply involved in the Sanger Corps and on the Pennsylvania German Hour and other Pennsylvania German activities. Services will be held privately at the graveside, but a memorial service is to be scheduled in the future. And we look forward to celebrating the life of Rachel M. Stump with her family and friends. Thank you, Rachel, for all that you have done over the years for the Sanger Corps and for the Pennsylvania German Hour here on BCTV. This morning, I'd also like to take a moment to thank all of my friends at the Nye Doppelhock Sanger Corps, the choir that would normally be singing with us every single month on BCTV. I'd like to express my gratitude and also the fact that I miss you all and look forward to a time when we can all be together again. This is the third month that I have been recording the show solo from a remote location and featuring cultural presentations and other topics aside from the normal routine of singing and doing an interview with a member of our community. I very much miss the old format, and I look forward to an opportunity in the near future of being able to work with the choir again and to showcase all the wonderful talent that we have in the Nye Dolbehock Sanger Corps. This morning we're doing a little bit something different, another presentation. This morning we're going to be exploring the culture of the Pennsylvania barn. Many people are aware that the Pennsylvania barn is an iconic feature in the Berks County and Lehigh County landscape and all throughout southeastern Pennsylvania. Today we're going to be taking a look at the barn and its role in the culture from a linguistic perspective. We're going to be talking about all the different parts of the barn and what they are called in the dialect. So I hope this morning you enjoy your brief glimpse of the Pennsylvania barn, or Die Pennsylvanische Shire. Today we're going to explore the Pennsylvania barn as a cultural icon throughout the southeastern Pennsylvania region. The name of the presentation today is Die Pennsylvanische Shire, en grosse Kapai im Nye Land. This is Pennsylvania Dutch, and it means the Pennsylvania barn, a large building in the New World. This emphasizes the fact that the barns we have here in Pennsylvania are not something that are directly imported from Europe, but rather something that culminated in a much larger and more robust tradition here in North America that's found nowhere else in the world. Although there are European precedents to many different architectural features we're going to see today, so many aspects of the barn and the way that it's been used throughout the century is distinctly Pennsylvania Dutch. And in keeping with this idea of the barn being one of the largest buildings in the traditional landscape, let's take a look at a traditional farmscape in Berks County. Die Bauerei is the word used for this whole comprehensive context of the family farm. Take a look at the barn and how much larger it is than any other building in the farmscape. You're going to see many other buildings, including the farmhouse, the piggery, which is right next to the barn. You're going to see chicken houses in the background, outhouses by the summer kitchen, which is next to the house. You're going to see many other geographical features as well. In the background, you can of course see that there are hay fields and grain fields, woodlots, all important parts of the landscape. In the foreground, you can see a meadow where the cows are allowed to graze. All of this carefully thought out, carefully planned agrarian landscape is what we consider to be the classic Berks County and Lehigh County farmscape. And of course, this is going to be found all throughout southeastern Pennsylvania, this particular type of farm layout, although it does vary from region to region. The barn, however, does play this really important role that you can see in the landscape visually, and in terms of its role and use and utility is one of the most important buildings in the agrarian landscape. When Domehen and Shani Shaya Mitchtana, a beautiful barn with stars. Our barns here in Pennsylvania are decorated in a manner that is quite unlike other parts of North America, even though these classic barn forms can be found all throughout the Midwest, all throughout Pennsylvania, all throughout North America. You will find that very few other parts of the United States have as many decorated barns in as small of a geographic area as southeastern Pennsylvania. Our barns are typically decorated with stars. When I began the process of documenting barns beginning in 2007, in 2008, I was primarily interested in the decorations on the barns, and since then my appreciation has extended well beyond the artistry to include the whole farm context. We have to recognize that so many different parts of the barn represent relationships especially with the land. When we're looking at the different materials that are used for construction, whether we're talking about the siding on the barn made out of wood that was locally sourced, stone that was also very locally sourced, many times from the very same farm or just nearby, and even the iron smelted in local foundries, all of these represent relationships with the craftspeople and the farm owners, and especially with the people and the land. And the raising of a barn is also a community expression, die Scheier zu aufschlauen, meaning to raise the barn up. This is something that was normally accomplished with as few as a dozen people, and sometimes many dozens of people who would gather together, fit each individual timber together, and erect these barns as part of a cooperative effort among neighbors. Many times folks knew that if you helped your neighbors raise their barn, they would also help you, and so there were forms of community reciprocity that were taking place in the raising of each individual barn that you see in our local landscape. Die früheste Scheire in Pennsylvania, or the earliest barns in Pennsylvania, are actually diverse forms that were built by some of the very first generations of settlers here in Pennsylvania. These are simpler forms than our classic Pennsylvania barn. While our classic Pennsylvania barn forms usually have two diagnostic features, an overhang called a forebay on one side, and they're banked into the earth, the earliest forms of barns in Pennsylvania are a little bit different. Many times these are single-story barns and are much humbler in terms of their construction. Again, they represent the very earliest forms in our Pennsylvania landscapes. One of those forms is the log barn. Log architecture has largely died out in most parts of Pennsylvania today, not to say that people don't undertake it occasionally for domestic architecture, but especially for barns, not so common in these days unless they're being re-erected or moved. Die Blockscheier, the log barn, ist die erste Scheier, as unser Vorelder gebaut hen. This is the very first type of barn that was typically built by the ancestors of the Pennsylvania Dutch here in this area, and typically it followed this particular pattern. It was referred to as a log crib barn due to the fact that it was consisting of two seemingly independent four-walled structures of logs that are joined together by a single roof, and there was a pass-through in the center or drive-through that had doors that protected both sides. This allowed farmers to pull into the wagon with a wagon to the barn to unload crops into the mows on either side, particularly hay and straw to unload into the mows, and the stables were below. And so this was a form of barn that was very easy to put up in certain respects. It could be put up without any form of nogging or chinking in between the logs. This particular barn that you see here is a recreation at the Landis Valley Farm Museum. And what you're typically going to find is that many of these barns were completely ventilated. There was no chinking or nogging in between the logs. This is, of course, the lime or clay-based substance that's put in between the logs. Many times it was allowed to be entirely open so that the barn would ventilate. And this allowed for the ventilation, especially of the mows up above. You can see that the upper logs in this structure are fully ventilated, but the lower area for the animals does have some nogging in this particular one. Over time, you can see that many of these types of barns in Pennsylvania were sided over. So in fact, oftentimes you didn't even get a chance to see them with any form of nogging at all because they were very rapidly sided over with many times softwood siding or hardwood. So you sometimes see pine or sometimes even oak that was put over top of the logs. And so many of these barns, especially where you might find them in parts of the Blue Mountain in the Schuylkill County area, which has more log barns than anywhere else, you're going to find a lot of those log barns have siding over top, and you would never recognize them today as log barns. And log barns come in many forms. I must clarify that not only do we have these very simple single-story barns like you see in this image here, but you also have complex two-story barns that are log as well and follow later patterns. So we'll talk about a bunch of different aspects of these barns throughout the presentation today, but this is the simplest type of barn that you would find in the earliest forms of settlement here in Pennsylvania, the Blockscheier, or log barn. And these log barns oftentimes were modified as subsequent generations built more permanent structures. Sometimes you'll find examples like this. This one is in Bucks County, right along the border with Montgomery. And this particular barn has a stable on either end that is composed of stone, but the mows above, the areas where you're going to be storing the hay and the straw, referred to as a mow or bora in Pennsylvania Dutch, these are the areas that are going to be open and ventilated with logs. Now this particular building here you can see has some vertical striping on the logs indicating again it had siding on it, so up until fairly recently you wouldn't have known that this was a log and stone barn. And of course our phrase for that in Pennsylvania Dutch is die Blok und Steh Scheier. It is composed of both Blok, which is log, and Steh, which is stone. inside, here is a close-up of one of the openings that goes into the straw mow up above the stables, and you can see that there's this large opening, so you could pull a wagon right into this barn and offload directly into this porthole that would allow you to take forkful after forkful of hay or straw and put it directly into the mow. Usually there were two mows in a barn like this, one for hay and one for straw. The straw was used for animal bedding and other utilitarian purposes, and the hay was typically used for animal fodder. These types of single-story barns are typically referred to as Bodumshire or Grundshire, both meaning ground barns. Bodum is this word specifically for the ground in Pennsylvania Dutch, but it can also, in this case, mean a basement, the lowest level of a building. And Grundshire typically means ground barn being on a ground level. So these are two different regional terms that are used throughout the parts of southeastern Pennsylvania where the dialect is still spoken. Und dies sind die erste Stehscheire gleich wie in Deutschland. So these were the very first stone barns you're going to find in this area, and in many ways they are similar to what you are going to find in Germany today. Now, when I have visited parts of southwestern Germany, in Swabia, but then also in the Pfalz, I was able to see a number of stone ground barns just like these that were the typical barns that you were going to find in the agrarian landscape. These were stone two-level barns, many times with a pass-through in the center. The only real difference you see, especially in southwestern Germany, is that many times barns and houses are combined. So not all barns are standalone from the house. But when they are, they follow a pattern that's very similar to our Bodumshire here in Pennsylvania, or our Grundshire, which are ground barns or basement-level barns. Here is a close-up of what you're going to see with the typical barn here in Pennsylvania of this type. You're going to see an example here of a barn that has a pass-through in the center. The landscape might be ever so slightly elevated and slightly banked for some of these ground barns, but typically it is a very, very gentle, not even full-story rise to get to that center area. And many of these are actually fully on grade where you don't see any form of gradual slope at all. On either end of the barn, you can see doors that go into the stables, one for cows, one for horses. You'll also see with this particular barn in the very center, there are not only are areas to go in with a wagon, but also areas to go in for a human as well on that slightly raised center platform. This would have gone into areas that flank the threshing floor on either side. And you can see, of course, that there are slit ventilators above the stables on either side of the barn to allow, again, for the storage of straw and hay. And this would, of course, allow for those areas to be ventilated. This particular barn was actually built by Caspar Mull following the Revolutionary War. Caspar Mull was a Hessian mercenary who was captured. And he was at a prison camp near Reading. Following the Revolutionary War, and he was later released. He was a person who spoke the German language, and after the Revolutionary War, he actually settled in Pennsylvania right alongside the Pennsylvania Dutch who had fought on the other side of the Revolution, and many times you're going to find that these Hessian mercenaries, they had no real loyalty to the English crown that they were serving at the time, so many times following the war, they just simply settled in Pennsylvania, and here's an example of a barn that was built by a first-generation immigrant who fought on the other side of the Revolution, but later settled in the Ole Valley and built this wonderful example of a stone ground barn. Here is an example of a Palatine ground barn from Flomborn. I was able to take a look at this barn in 2018 when I was visiting one of our colleagues, Dr. Michael Werner, who is the publisher of the Hiva Vidriva newspaper. I was over there doing some presentations, and Dr. Werner was able to show me a number of wonderful properties and barns all throughout the region. And this particular barn is in Flomborn in Altsei-Worms. This is actually the hometown of the family of the Pennebeckers, or later called the Pennypackers in Pennsylvania. Governor Pennypacker was a very influential Pennsylvania Dutch governor among the Pennsylvania Dutch, and of course the governor of the entire state, not just of the Pennsylvania Dutch, but his ancestral hometown in the Falls was Flomborn. And here's an example of a stone ground barn. You can see on the one side of the barn, it follows a very similar pattern to what you find here in Pennsylvania. The other side had some form of a wooden structure, a frame structure at one point in time that has since been removed, which is why you see that kind of staggered roof line on the right. But this particular Palatine ground barn follows mostly the same type of structure and configuration that you're going to find here in Pennsylvania, and is a great example of a European barn that would have served as a form of inspiration for the barns that were later erected in southeastern Pennsylvania by those who were coming out of the faults. Another type of barn that you're going to find in southeastern Pennsylvania, an early type, is an English barn, the Englishia. Un sie vor gebaut by unsere englische Nachbarn und sie vor ihre Stehscheire. These were built by the English neighbors of the Pennsylvania Dutch and were also stone barns. This particular form is largely found in Chester County, Delaware County, in the areas immediately surrounding Philadelphia, but then to some degree you will find them in Lancaster County. You'll also find examples in Northampton and Lehigh, and also in Berks. And so this is a very important form. I should also say you find them, of course, in Montgomery County as well. So when you're looking throughout this southeastern Pennsylvania area, within the area where you saw a fair amount of influence, especially from the English Quakers, you were going to find examples of these barns being built, not only among the Quakers, but also among the Pennsylvania Dutch as well. These were to some degree also adopted by German-speaking settlers who were building stone barns, many times as the second installation of a barn on their farm complex. Many of the first-generation barns were log construction, and oftentimes within just about a generation or so, people were building stone barns. So they had two different options. They were either borrowing the style of barn that was commonly in place by their English neighbors, such as the case of these English barns, sometimes referred to as English Lake District barns because they so closely resemble barns from the Lake District in England. But you also, of course, had other forms of barns that were readily copied by that first generation of folks who were building their stone barns in Pennsylvania. And, of course, many of these were borrowing Swiss features, and we're going to discuss those more at length in this presentation as well. The English barns, of course, were in many different forms, and you typically found that they had central threshing doors on the second floor. Oftentimes you're going to see a pent roof that would run just along the upper area over the stable level, which is on the ground level, and this particular type of barn also was banked, as the Pennsylvania barn is. So you'll notice no overhang like what we consider to be a classic Pennsylvania barn, but instead you're going to see that there was this little overhang of a pent roof, and on this particular image the pent roof is no longer there, but you can see that there is this kind of dotted line across the midsection of the barn indicating where there was this tiny little overhang, not a full forebay, which is an upper story extension on the second floor, but instead you'll see that this was just a little roof that sheltered those stable doors on the lower level. This barn is in Mazellum Springs, Berks County, and is from the 1770s. Is a fabulous example of a local barn, and it is one of the only English-style barns in this part of Berks County, just outside of Kutztown. Here's another example that you'll see, I should say the same example, another view of the same barn from the bank side. You can see it has that classic form of being banked into the earth, so you can walk right into the barn on the second floor or drive a wagon in to unload your crops. All along the gable end, you're going to see these splayed loopholes that are very similar to what you see in medieval architecture and early modern architecture as well for ventilation. These are not as some people have suggested, rifle holes that were used during the Revolution. Certainly there were some stone barns during the Revolution, but generally speaking, those barns were used as hospitals or other situations, and of course used as barns during that time period as well. But these were not typically built with any idea in mind other than ventilation. Whether anybody ever hung a rifle out of them is yet to be determined. We don't have documentation of this. However, we will say that these particular types of ventilators are common throughout the region, and they were primarily used for ventilation of the barn. If you didn't ventilate the ends of the barns that were used as hay mows, typically what you're going to find is if that hay had any moisture in it, it could actually cause spontaneous combustion. This has happened even in recent years in Berks County, where barns catch fire because there's residual moisture in the hay before it's put into the hay mow. This might sound a little strange to those of you who aren't from a farming background, but if you have a high percentage of moisture content in your hay, it does pose a very significant risk to your barn. So folks knew this early on, and even the earliest barns in our communities were equipped with ventilators to allow for the ventilation of the hay and the straw when it was put into the barn. The Pennsylvania barn is often a confusing term to local people, the Pennsylvania Shire. These are not all barns in Pennsylvania. The Pennsylvania barn is an architectural term that is specifically used to refer to our four-bay bank barns, barns that have a four-bay overhang that are banked into the earth. This particular style of barn was developed in southeastern Pennsylvania and spread all throughout the United States. The earliest Pennsylvania barn is the Schweizer Shire, or the Schweizer barn, which means the Swiss barn, because this particular barn has an influence coming from Alpine Swiss architecture. The two diagnostic features that make a Pennsylvania barn are clearly visible in this form of Schweizer barn. The Schweizer is the earliest form of the Pennsylvania barn, and it combines the overhang known as a forebay, which can be seen directly above me. It's this overhang that shelters the stable level and also provides a second story, well-ventilated area for the storage of crops before threshing. On the left-hand side, you can also see that there is a gentle slope to the landscape, providing the second diagnostic feature, which is the ramp access getting into the second floor of the barn. You can drive a wagon right up onto the second floor to unload your crops. This particular form of Pennsylvania barn is very distinctive because oftentimes in southeastern Pennsylvania, you're going to find that there is an asymmetrical roof line. This asymmetrical roof line is formed from the fact that you have this large forebay extension on the front of the barn, and the forebay, for many of the stone forms of the Schweizer barn, is essentially an add-on feature. It is certainly an original feature to the barn, but it is not integral in terms of its framing. It is a lot lighter in terms of its framing. And it was something that was constructed onto the central timber frame of the barn, as well as the stone gables of the barn. So it has this very distinctive feature, especially when you see the forebay hanging off of the front of the rest of the stone structure. Now, for later Schweizer barns, it is much more integral when you find frame barns, especially those in the central part of Pennsylvania. Oftentimes, there is no visible separation between the front overhang of the Schweizer. Many times, there's still an asymmetrical roof line, but you'll see that it is a much more comprehensive appearance to the barn when the entire upper story is framed in and unified by a single layer of siding all across the barn. The interesting thing is, too, you'll find in some of the central Pennsylvania barns that also are considered Schweitzers, there are sometimes bank sheds in the back. So actually an additional area on the back of the barn on either side of the bank ramp of the barn that appears to create a symmetrical roofline. So many times Schweitzers sometimes come in different forms, but they still have this very distinctive form of light framing in the front for the forebay. And oftentimes as well, you'll notice that the stone wall terminates before the forebay starts, even for barns that are framed on the second floor. And we're going to see some nice examples of some standard Pennsylvania barns as well, where the forebay is entirely contained within the stone structure of the barn and has a very distinctive appearance that is different from the Schweitzer barn. The Schweitzer also can be found in other parts, we are believing, of the Kurpfalz, which is this broader swath of southwestern Germany. It is very rare to find examples of these, and we believe that many of them are no longer extant in the landscape, but a good example comes from Zinsheim. Here's an example of a Zinsheimer Shire, a barn from Zinsheim that has this very distinctive form of the Schweitzer barn that we would consider to be a Swiss influence into even this part of southwestern Germany. There is a distinctive overhang, an asymmetrical roof line, and you see the lower level has these stable doors across the bottom, and the upper level has a set of double doors that are considered the threshing doors of the barn. These are in place to allow for ventilation of the barn. You could open them up in the front and then open the bank doors in the back, and it would allow for the threshing of grain in that central platform and then the storing of primarily the straw and the hay on either side of the barn. This particular barn also is a different kind of timber frame structure than what you typically find in Pennsylvania, where most of our timber frame barns oftentimes are covered with siding. This particular one is a half timber structure, which you can see that there is a plaster or masonry infill in between all of the timber frame members. So you can see that there is actually daubing in between there, and it creates a very distinctive European appearance. Now, in early Pennsylvania, there were examples of barns that were half timbered. However, many of these barns are no longer extant in our landscape today, although there are a handful of them. The other feature of the Schweitzer barn, of course, is this bank ramp that you can see, as I mentioned before. Take a look at this asymmetrical roof line. This is one of the things that's very easy to pick out for most of the Schweitzers in southeastern Pennsylvania. Again, when you go into central PA, oftentimes there are bank ramps that are flanked on either side by bank sheds that make the roof line more or less symmetrical. So don't rely on that purely as the only diagnostic feature of this early Schweitzer barn, the earliest form of the Pennsylvania barn. Here again, you can see this asymmetrical roof line and der Vorschuss, which is the forebay of the barn. Here's the gable end of a standard barn. You can see that it does not have that protruding forebay that you'll typically find on the Schweitzer barn. Instead, what you're actually seeing here is a stone gable, and the forebay is contained within the gable profile. This particular standard barn that we're seeing here has an Halbsteggiebel, or a half stone gable with a framed in upper gable apex. You're going to find standard barns that have stone all the way to the peak, and sometimes stone just to the eave level, and also occasionally just the stone on the stable level and frame above. This is especially common in the late 19th century, and especially in the midsection of Pennsylvania, in central Pennsylvania. You'll also find examples of barns that are framed entirely above the stable level. This particular barn has what we would refer to as a Hilsnagiebel, or a frame wood-covered gable. You can see on the gable end of this barn a mail pouch tobacco barn as well. And this tobacco advertisement was very common at one point in time when local painting crews employed by the mail pouch tobacco company would go out and paint their logos on the sides of barns. This particular barn is owned by the late Carl Schneider, who was the Hauptmann of Groundhog Lodge No. 1, one of the local dialect preservation societies in Lehigh County. And unfortunately, you can see I'm overlapping my caption here, but the Pennsylvania Dutch here says, "Die Vorschuss fand ist der Platz, wo man Sterne findet." This is the place where we would find stars on the barn, right on the forebay wall. Sometimes you'll find them on the gable ends, but especially on this front forebay wall. And you'll find them typically in symmetrical arrangements across the front of the barn. This particular barn, you can also see, has many different decorative forms. Not only does it have seven pointed stars with little tiny stars in between each star point, you'll You'll also find the individual four-pointed stars or four-pointed crosses above the windows and doorways, and a decorative feature along the very bottom of the forebay as well, showing this triangular overlapping pattern at the very bottom. So it's part of a comprehensive decorative scheme across the front of the forebay. You'll also see here examples of many of the different forms of the barn stars throughout our region, primarily in Berks and Lehigh, but you'll also find them in Montgomery and in Schuylkill and in Northampton and other areas as well. Typically in Berks County, you're going to find stars. You're going to find eight-pointed stars, especially with overlapping scallop borders many times, just like the one that's to the bottom center, known as the Milton Hill Star. It's a distinctive form of star named after a particular artist by the name of Milton Hill. He was an artist who was the most prolific artist in the early 20th century, had a very distinctive form. So all of these stars that you're going to find throughout these different parts of southeastern Pennsylvania are many times distinctive to particular artists and have distinctive regionalisms. The stars in Berks County primarily were referred to as Shtana, but when you go into Lehigh County and parts of northern Montgomery County, you're going to find barn decorations that are more floral in nature, six-pointed rosettes, and also tulip patterns with teardrop formations that look a little bit like the petals of flowers. Folks would refer to these also as bloemen, meaning flowers in Pennsylvania Dutch, but you'll also find the word dullabonne being used as well, or even staanbloemen. Dullabonne means tulips, and staanbloemen means Star of Bethlehem, which is a particular form of six-pointed star that is actually out right now. It's an ephemeral late and mid-spring flower that blooms for a short while. It has a six-pointed appearance, just like our six-pointed rosettes. So we can see that these were not only considered stars, but also flowers throughout the Dutch country. And especially there's two regions, as I mentioned before, typically along the Blue Mountain in northern Berks, in southern Schuylkill and northern Lehigh. Along the Blue Mountain Ridge, you're going to see eight-pointed stars referred to as die Shtana. And in southern Berks, especially where it meets up with Bucks and Lehigh and Montgomery, you are going to find die Blume, or the more floral elements as well. You'll also find those in Northampton County as well. And of course, these stars are going to be found in many different arrangements and diverse forms throughout southeastern Pennsylvania. And there are over 500 decorated barns in southeastern Pennsylvania, over 400 in Berks County alone. On either side of the forebay, on the stable level, you'll find stone piers. These stone piers are usually composed of what we would call coin stones in English, or die Pila Stay in Pennsylvanish. These are regular cut rectangular stones that provide structural support to the front of the barn with the forebay side, usually for being able to anchor the front sill of the forebay and to support that forebay on either end. Here are examples of the beams of the foreshoes, and the foreshoes, or the forebow, is the forebay of the barn. You can look up underneath on the stable level and see all of these large beams that are hand-hewn. Sometimes they're shaped, sometimes these still have bark on two sides. It just depends on the maker of the barn, how elaborate they got. And here again is this pilar eck, the little corner that's formed by that stone return. Some standard barns don't have this, but this is found especially in Berks County, but you'll find it in Berks and Lehigh and Lancaster and many other parts where the Pennsylvania barn form, especially the standard barn, is predominant. Sometimes in Northampton County and occasionally in Berks and some other areas, you'll find a closet in the pilarek, which is perfect for storing harnesses and other horse tack. This was a wonderful addition to many Pennsylvania barns because it allowed for storage of items that could be kept away from the elements and away from rats or mice that might be on the farm. You could keep your harnesses and your leather goods in there. This is referred to as the pilarek shrunk, or that pier corner closet. On this lower level, you can see die Gaul und Kuhstall. These are the horse and cow stable. a very important feature that you'll find in the stable level, especially for the horse stables, and nowhere else, is the Sprigel. The Sprigel is a pocket bolt that is usually found on maybe one or two barns in the horse stables of the barn. It comes out of the door frame by means of a little sliding pocket area in the wall and adjoins to the opposite side of the door frame. It keeps the horses in and allows the air to circulate if you open the doors. What you see here is an example of what we would refer to as the Gallstall Diaspriegel, or the horse stall door bolt. Another word you can use is bar as well. So the Gallstall Diaspriegel halt die Geil drin und lass die Luft umlaufen. The horse stall door bar keeps the horses in and lets the air circulate. And the rarest form of this sliding door bolt is the Doppelgallstall Diaspriegel, which is the double door bolt found on the horse stables. Many times also in the horse stables you'll find the Strigelkasta, or the curry box. This is where you would keep your combs to curry or to groom the horses. And oftentimes there's a little bit of an edge or a lip on the curry box as well, so you could put your combs in there and keep them in for brushing down the horses after bringing them in from the fields or from work especially. This is a process that feels really good on the animals when they're brushed down, and it also keeps them healthy. Inside the barn, on the horse side, you're also many times going to see the Futterdrog und Heuref. Now, the Heuref is typically referred to as the manger, and the Futterdrog is the feeding trough. Now, this feeding trough is along the bottom. You can typically pour grain into that lower portion, and hay is put into the Heuref, or the hay frame, or hay manger up above. Typically, you're going to find a similar type of construction in the cow stables as well, but it is lower because the cows can't reach as high as the horses, and the horses are typically fed on a higher level than the cows because of the height of the animals. These are not typically found in most modern renovated barns today, but you will find these as original features in many of the early 19th century and mid-19th century barns all throughout Berks County, and earlier than that as well. Here is a view from the inside of the barn looking towards the stable doors in the Futtergang, or the feed aisle. This was an area of the barn that was limited access only just for humans. You can notice that on either side there are feeding troughs down below and hay mangers up above, so that an individual could walk into the aisle and distribute grain to the horses below and hay above. This is also a very, very important area where you'll find chutes for grain to come down that were usually fed by gravity from the granary, and you'll also find hay drops where you could drop hay from the upper story to feed to the animals. And in some of the oldest barns that we see in our landscape, there are sometimes root cellars underneath the bank ramp. Sometimes they're accessible from a door on the outside, other times it's in the horse side, that you could open up the back of the barn and walk in to an area where you would actually be able to store root vegetables that were typically used as animal fodder. Roots were sometimes fed to cows and also especially to pigs, but usually not so much for horses. But here's an example of one that was accessible from the horse side of the barn. You can go in and actually see what this cellar looks like. Here is a view of a 50-foot-long root cellar on a barn that is around 100 feet long underneath the bank for about 50 feet of that back side of the barn. You can see the root cellar accessible only from the inside of the barn. And this is where, again, some animal fodder, especially root crops, were being stored. And you'd have easy access then to be able to feed them to the cows and also bring them out for pigs, which would have been in the pig house next to the barn. This is an unusual feature, but I know of examples of some in Hereford Township as well as in the Oley Valley. The Shiakella is what you would refer to the root cellar as, especially when it's underneath that barn bank. Some barns also have Stalldiere, or stable doors, that are located on the gable end of the barn. Usually one of these doors leads into a feed aisle for just human beings, and then the other is access for draft animals, and for farmers to be able to take their draft animals out of the barn on the gable end in order to avoid having to go all the way through the barnyard. And many times this gable end stall door would allow for simple access to the farm fields. Now the Eifort or the Scheibrich, these are the ramp side entrances to the barn for the second story. Now here's an example of something referred to as a bank ramp. This is actually banked earth that is built up with a stone retainer on either side in order to access the second story of the barn. Not all barns have what we would technically call a bank ramp. Many times the landscape itself is just gently sloped, and it's not a ramp that was constructed, but one that was just mere convenience for being part of the local landscape, of having a gently rolling hill on the landscape on the site of the barn. The Eifort is usually one that was actually artificially built to access the second story, like this one with a stone retainer. You'll also see those that are referred to as barn bridges. These are oftentimes arched because not only does it allow to help defray the pressure, the hydrostatic pressure of the earth against that back wall of the barn, which can sometimes put undue pressure on that back wall and sometimes cause issues with the masonry at the lower level of the barn. But other times you'll find that these were actually helpful for being able to park wagons under or use for storage. This particular one is a little bit lower than what you would typically find for a wagon parking area, but especially on some other barns like double-decker barns, you'll find massive barn bridges where you could store a wagon and still have plenty of room. You could actually store a loaded wagon under some of those. Here's an example of the Doppelshire or the double-decker barn. This type of barn has actually three different levels. It has two layers above, which is why it's called a double barn or a double-decker barn, and it has one level below for the stables. You can see that there is a Scheibrich or a Shire, a barn bridge on the left-hand side where you can actually pull a loaded wagon underneath that edge. And of course, this was an access point not only for wagons into the second floor, but then also to be able to use the second level up, which would be the threshing floor. That's technically the third story of the barn. You would thresh the grain and then drop it down below. This is especially common in areas that had an English Quaker influence. You'll find these in Chester County, you'll find them in Delaware County, and you'll find them also in parts of Lancaster County. Now, the other part that we're going to see when we go into this banked access, we're going to see the threshing room and the hay and straw mows. Es dresch den und die Heu und Stroh bohre. So inside the barn, when you walk in, you're going to immediately see that the inside of the barn is separated into rooms or gebelk. Gebelk are the bent frames, or Eskebelk is a single bent frame. A bent frame is not actually something that's bent over. The bent is an architectural term for the frames that hold the barn together on the inside. And you'll also find that the interior timber frames feature little numerals that you can use as the builder to put all of the framing members together when the barn is raised in order to be able to join like members that were intended to be joined together. So you'll many times see matching Roman numerals. These individual hatch marks are oftentimes deroute, or sometimes die Picke, depending on what form of notation you have. Die Rote are the words specifically for the Roman numerals, and die Picke are situations where you just have hatch marks used to join the timbers together. Some people refer to these as marriage marks because the marks are very similar to one another. They should match for each individual area of joining, so they are a marriage of two timbers that are to be put together. Die Heuleiter, or the hay ladders, are also very important features in the barn. Here's an example of one that goes all the way up to the peak of the roof. This came from a time when you would have been stacking the hay loose in the barn. This preceded the time when you would find baling technology being used. Early 19th century baling technology, it did not yet exist. 18th century, it certainly didn't exist. You really start seeing people adopting this usually in the early 20th century, but sometimes as early as the late 19th century. And here's a good example of a barn that is filled to the gills with bales today. And you see at the very bottom of these hay ladders, many times little footholds. And these footholds are in what we would refer to as die Dennwand. Die Dennwand are the Maustead walls, and the little holes are called die Fußlecker. And these would be the holes that you use to climb to get to the hay ladders to access the hay mows, especially when those mows are just absolutely stuffed full of hay. Here's an example of the Maustead wall. Maustead walls are, again, the areas that flank the threshing area of the barn. You would do your threshing in the very central part of the barn, typically, and then on either end are the mows where the hay and straw are stored. These are typically referred to as Maustead walls in English because they help to hold back the mow. This would be a barrier that would especially help to keep the loosely stacked hay that was common in the early 19th century and mid-19th century. It would keep those hay stacks inside the barns in the mows. It would help to retain them. Usually this is referred to as a Maustead wall in English, but in the Pennsylvania Dutch terminology, it's a Dennwand, and den refers to the Esdreschden, which is the area in the center of the barn where you're going to be doing your threshing. So it's literally the threshing room walls. And oftentimes these are the most decorated parts of the interiors of the barns in terms of graffiti. You're going to find names and dates, sometimes elaborate stars like this example here. Und da ist der Dreschdenboden, or the threshing room floor. Typically, the grain processing took place directly on this floor, which is consisting of large planks held together with splines so that none of the grain would fall through the cracks in the boards. And this floor is oftentimes one of the most worn parts in a barn, not only because you're pulling wagons in and out, but also because the threshing was typically done with flails directly on these boards. So you're going to have this floor getting a lot of impact over time from the fact that you're using flails to separate the individual kernels of grain from the straw of the grain. The grain was then scooped up off the floor and put into the granary, and then the straw was put into the straw mows. Inside of the barn, you'll also see many times there are ventilators on either end of the mows. These come in a lot of different shapes and sizes, and you're going to find two words used for them. Typically, you'll find the word die Schwalmelecker. Schwalm is the word for a swallow, and Schwalme is plural for swallows. So die Schwalmelecker are the holes on either end of the barn to allow swallows into the barn. They would keep insects down, and they were thought to be good luck. Another alternate term is Luftlöcher, and these are the terms for ventilators in particular. Luft is the word for air. So Luftloch is singular for Luftlöcher, which are ventilators, and this would allow the air into either end of the barn in order to help make sure that your mows are going to be able to have dry storage of straw and hay. The granary, or die Fruchtkammer, is a very important part of the barn. The Fruchtkammer is usually one of the most closely fitting doors on the barn in order to make sure it can be secured against any form of mice. Oftentimes in modern adaptations today, you'll see people using old license plates or pieces of tin to patch holes on the Fruchtkammer or in the Fruchtkammer, which is the granary and the granary door. You'll be able then, of course, to store your grain in there and have a very secure place to help keep any form of mice out. On the door, you'll usually see what they might refer to as a Riegelschloss or a bolt latch. Many times, this is one of the few places you'll occasionally see a keyed latch on a barn as well. Most other doors are not locked historically, but the granary was because it held a lot of the most important aspects of your agricultural output each year, your grain that was going to be used to feed your animals. And you wanted to guard this not only against pests such as insects and mice, but also against any potential thieves. So occasionally you'll not only see this Riegelschloss or your sliding bolt latch, but also occasionally a box lock as well. And here's an example of the granary, the Fruchtkammer. And inside of the granary, you'll also see examples of these individual partition walls or the granary bins. The gallner are the grain bins. These are areas where you'd be able to shovel the grain directly off of the threshing floor and into the grain bins, and you'd be able to oftentimes feed the grain down to the animals by means of chutes. And of course, on your granary walls, you'll also see lots of old notations. Many farmers kept their ledgers directly on the wall where they had hatch marks to keep track of harvests, and many times transactions can be found on the walls with the names of particular farmers and how many bushels of oats or barley or rye they were going to be buying. And so when you look at the inside of the granary walls, you're going to find all kinds of marika, or the markings of the farmers. And some old barns also have other types of inscriptions referred to as Shaya Zegen, or barn blessings. I apologize that the caption here is cut off at the bottom, but that should say barn blessings. Here's an example of one from Sinking Spring, Berks County, from 1802. It says, Gott kann bauen und abbrechen, er kann geben und kann nehmen, jedem nach es ihm gefällt. It means, God can build and he can tear down, he can give and he can take to each as it pleases him. At the very bottom it says, Henrik Erzmauer, and Erz was the person's last name. Henry Hartz was probably the way we would pronounce his name today, and Mauer means the stonemason. So he was the stonemason, and he put this religious inscription on the barn underneath the edge of the forebay in 1802. And this particular barn is right in Sinking Spring. To conclude this episode of the Pennsylvania German Hour, I'd like to offer the following proverb found above a sundial in Richmond Township on a local barn. The inscription originally was in Latin, and it says, Transit umbra manent opera. It means, the shadow moves, but the works remain. So as the shadow of the sundial moves, the works of our hands are going to continue to live after us. And in Pennsylvania Dutch, we would say this as, De schade gaat rum, aber die arbeid blijft. This communicates the fact that what we do with our hands, what we do with our lives, how we spend our time is going to live after us and continue to communicate to future generations about the contents of our hearts, what we value, and what we hope to accomplish. Zelus alles was ich hab für die Pennsylvanische Deutschstunde. That's all I have for today for the Pennsylvania German Hour. I hope you enjoyed this small glimpse of the Pennsylvania barn, and I'd like to offer one last thought. Bleib heim, bleib sicher, und bleib gesund. Stay home, stay safe, and stay healthy. Mach's gut.
The Pennsylvania German Hour is underwritten by the Pennsylvanische Deutsche Versammlung von Baddox County, the state's largest annual Pennsylvania Dutch language gathering, held the first Monday after Easter in the Leesport Auction Hall. For more information, please call Joyce Hassler at 717-866-3431. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the West Berks Versammlung, held annually on the first Saturday in October in Robezonia. For more information, please call Kathy Shellhammer at 610-390-1088. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the Rentschler Laib family and Reverend Richard Miller and family. The Pennsylvania German Hour is produced in cooperation with the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center at Kutztown University, the hub of Pennsylvania Dutch culture and language. Contact us at 610-683-1589 or at www.kutztown.edu/pgchc. Mir sauer Großdank zu alle unsere Unterstützer.